Hi all. So the today's topic is under the wireless local area networks, which we are considering as a Bluetooth technology. So this Bluetooth technology is where we are trying to set up a small network, that is local area network, with respect to few number of devices or gadgets or few number of equipments that are available in and around with the usage of the wireless communication. Let us understand what is this Bluetooth. It's a wireless LAN technology designed to connect different devices which may perform different functions, like our computers or mouse, keypad, cameras, printers, coffee makers, Fitbit watches, telephones, notebooks, mobile phones, etc. For exchange of data, it may be the exchange of image, it may be the exchange of information, or any kind of information. When I say information, it can be a music file, it can be a data file, or it can be a document, anything. So this Bluetooth, it is an ad hoc network. So when we say it is an ad hoc network, it means it is a network which has been set up then and there. So it's a spontaneous network which is being formed. So this will have devices, which we basically call it as gadgets. Each one of them have these gadgets can find another gadgets which are enabled with Bluetooth. So when both the Bluetooth devices are enabled, so they both can communicate with each other. They have several applications, like these devices may be used to have, all as already mentioned, like wireless mouse can get connected with the keyboard and can communicate with the computer with the usage of the Bluetooth technology. So this is one small application of your Bluetooth. One more application concerned with respect to the Bluetooth is, like, we can have a Bluetooth Fitbit watch, and that Fitbit watch, which is enabled with this Bluetooth technology, will communicate with your mobile phone to update the data regarding the number of footsteps that has been taken per day or for our on hourly basis, or even it will take into consideration the pulse rate, that is the heart rate of a particular person who is wearing the Fitbit watch, and the person who is having the mobile phone. It will also help us to take up the calls, listen to the music on the go. So that's the application of Bluetooth. Even it is used in some of the home security devices, as well it is used in monitoring devices in case of healthcare centers. So today this particular Bluetooth technology, it was actually a project which was started by Ericsson company. So this project was then taken up and translated to English as Bluetooth. Earlier it was called as Baltand, which is translated to Bluetooth, right? So today this Bluetooth technology is the implementation of a protocol defined by the standard IEEE 802.15. The standard which holds this Bluetooth is 802.15. This standard defines a wireless personal area network operable in an area that is very small size, like a room or a hall. So in this particular session, we'll be discussing about the architecture of the Bluetooth layers, baseband layers, and L2CAP. L2CAP is the logic link control and adaptation protocol. So since it is logic link, two times L is repeating, so that is shortened as L2CAP, logic link control and adaptation protocol. So we will soon look into the working of this particular Bluetooth with respect to the architecture. There are two types of networks which is being followed by the Bluetooth architecture, that is PicoNet and Scatternet. The PicoNet architecture, we call this is a very small network. So in short, it is called as small net. So this PicoNet will have or can connect up to 8 number of stations. So it will have a primary station and it will have all the rest as the secondary stations. So coming to this PicoNet, this primary station, it can have one-to-one communication between a primary and a secondary station, or this primary station can have one-to-many kind of communication which is being established. So as it is told, it is a PicoNet. The number of stations that it can connect here is up to 8 number of stations, but not the 8th one here. This 8th station here is not allowed in communication here because this 8th station will be there in the parked state. Parked state in the sense it will be there in the standby mode. So let all the devices communicate and exchange the information with the primary station. Once an active device which is there already present goes to the parked state, then the device which is there in the parked state can come back to the active state and establish the connection with the primary device and have the communication be done. So that is how this PicoNet is going to work. And remember that all the secondary stations which are present here, not only 1, 2, 3, 4 or up to 8, all will have the synchronization of the clock, synchronization of their clock being done with the primary station. So that primary knows the information of at what hopping sequence the second device is present, third device is present, fourth device is present, and so on. So the synchronization of the clock and the hopping sequence will be sent from the secondary device to the primary device. Moving on to the next architecture, we have got one more architecture which we or a one more type of network which we call it as scatternet. So if I combine several PicoNets, it will form a scatternet. Any secondary station which is there present in the first PicoNet can act as a primary station in the second PicoNet. So that is the beauty in case of scatternet. A secondary station in one PicoNet can be the primary in the another PicoNet. This station, it can receive the message from the primary station as though it is acting as a secondary station here when it is present in this particular first network. So when it comes to the second network, so what it can do is it will act as a primary station and transfer that information to the secondary devices available there. So a station can be a member of two PicoNets, like it is acting here. For the first one, it is going to act as a secondary, and for the second PicoNet, it is going to act as a primary. So that's the construction of the scatternet. So coming to the Bluetooth devices that are available here, these are basically short-range radio transmitters. The current rate which is supported by any Bluetooth is 1 megabits per second, 1 Mbps. And the bandwidth is 2.4 gigahertz. So this is possibly a small range, or this is possibly going to be a short range. So that's why it is going to make use of a short range radio transmitter. Then moving on to the next topic, which is Bluetooth layers. Bluetooth uses several layers, which is somewhat similar to, or even though it is not exactly matching with that of the internet model, we have the particular layered architecture which is as given here. Coming to the very first layer, which is radio layer. So this radio layer is equivalent to the physical layer which is present in the internet model. So this Bluetooth is basically a low power device and have a range of around 10 meters. So within 10 meters, we can have the connection being established with one more Bluetooth device. And we already noticed that the bandwidth that it is making to use, going to make use is of 2.4 gigahertz ISM band, which means this 2.4 gigahertz band is divided into 79 channels. Of this is basically divided into 79 channels of 1 megahertz each. 1 megahertz each. So the radio layer here, it is going to make use of, or the Bluetooth is going to make use of frequency hopping spread spectrum method, which is a type that we have already seen in wireless LANs, like to implement a physical layer. It is basically used to avoid the interference from one device to another in the other networks. So this Bluetooth hops 1600 times per second. So the hop time of this particular Bluetooth is 1600 times per second, which means that each device changes its modulation frequency. So now for the first time, it may be having a modulation frequency of 1 megahertz. To change it to the next modulation frequency, it requires a time of 1600 per second. So a device uses a frequency for only 625 microseconds. So if I say for how long the device is going to make use of that particular channel or that particular frequency, it is 1 over 1600 seconds, which is nothing but 625 microseconds. Then coming to the next layer, which is baseband layer, this is equivalent to that of the MAC sublayer, which is present in local area network. The access method used in this MAC sublayer here is TDMA, which is time division multiple access. So the primary and secondary communicate with each other using the time slots. The length of each of the time slot is exactly same as that we have already seen, which is 625 microseconds. So the length of the time slot will be just 625 microseconds. This means during this time, that one frequency is used. A sender sends a frame to a secondary, or a secondary sends a frame to the primary. So only one iteration can happen here, not two iteration. If a primary is present, primary can send during that first time slot to the data to the or information to the secondary, and secondary or a secondary can send the frame to the primary. Note that the communication which is present here is only between primary and secondaries. Never secondary and secondary can communicate. It is always primary to secondary and secondary to primary. The secondary to secondary communication is not possible. So TDMA, which is used for this Bluetooth, it uses a form of TDMA, that is TDD TDMA, time division duplexing TDMA. What is this time division duplexing? That is TDD TDMA is a kind of half duplex communication in which the secondary and receiver send and receive data, but not at the same time, which means only one can receive the data and receive the data, send the data and receive the data, which cannot happen at the same iteration. We cannot transmit the data as well as receive at the same instant of time, which is half duplex in nature. So however, the communication for each direction uses different hops. Now the hops is going to be different. It is not going to be the first hop. In the same first hop, we are not going to again receive the data. It is going to be two iteration. For example, which we basically make use similar to that type of your walkie talkie is the best example. Then coming to the types of communications that are available in this baseband layer. One is single secondary communication and then multiple secondary communication. So the single secondary communication. This is a type of communication where we can see that there is only one secondary device present. So there is only one primary, there is only one secondary. So what we do in this particular kind of architecture or a network that is present is we allow this PicoNet, or we allow this PicoNet which has only one secondary device to follow the TDD TDMA, which means we are trying to first device. Note that this is not milliseconds, it is microseconds, 625 microseconds. Each slot is divided as 625 microseconds. The primary uses all the even numbered slots, and the secondary uses odd numbered slots. So what is odd numbered and even numbered is primary is going to transmit at 0, 2, 4. So at those time slots it is going to transmit the data to the secondary. So that will be the slot which will be allocated for the secondary device. Now if it when it comes for the secondary device, I said secondary is going to make use of the odd number of slots, which is F1, F3 and F5 and so on, right? So during this slot, the secondary can send the data, whatever the information it has got, to the primary device. So this cycle keeps on repeating whenever we have single secondary device. Coming to, let us see how it works when it has got multiple secondary communication. So in this type of communication, we are looking at, we are having a kind of the process is having more number of secondary devices in the given small PicoNet. So I have a primary device, I have two secondary devices here, secondary 1 and secondary 2. So this secondary 1 and secondary 2 are going to make use of the devices, or going to look for who is going to send the information to the primary. So here for the primary, the rule remains the same, like it is always going to transmit only for the even numbered of slots, like 0, 2 and 4 and so on. And remember, the time slot here is 625 microsecond for this particular time slot. So primary always keeps on transmitting the data to any of the secondary in that particular slot, that is even numbered slots. So during the odd slots, to whomever the primary packet has been transmitted, now you can see from primary, secondary one is getting the packet. So for the next odd interval, who has to answer that frame is, it has to be answered by secondary one. So likewise, at the time slot, at the even time slot two, my primary is transmitting the frame to secondary two. On the same lines, for the next odd slot, the frame has to be responded or replied from the secondary 2 to the primary, and this continues. Whomsoever is being addressed, which secondary device is being addressed from the primary, the same secondary device has to respond back to the primary. This we can say like it is going to access access method that we have already seen, like poll or select operation with reservation. Like when the primary selects the secondary, it polls it. The next time slot, it is reserved for polled station to send its frame. If the polled secondary has no frame to send, the channel is kept silent. So that's how the multiple secondary communication is going to happen in case of this particular in a year where we were looking for the baseband layer transmission with the baseband layer working with the usage of the TDMA, which is basically time division duplex TDMA, which is a half duplex kind of communication. Let us move ahead. Understand the frame format used in the baseband layer. A frame in a baseband layer can be one of three types, like one slot, three slot, or five slot. So depending upon whether we are making use of one slot, three slot, or five slot, we have the description of the frame format which is given here. So if it is one slot, then the frame, that particular one slot frame can last from 625 to 366 microseconds. And if it is a three slot frame, it can go up to 1616 microseconds. And if it is a five slot frame, it can take up to 2866 bits, which is how many number of hoppings that it is basically going to take. So depending upon the number of slots, like it is already given, if it is one slot, the number of bits will be 240. If it is three slots, it is 1490. And if it is five slot frame, it is going to be 2740 bits. So this is how we actually look for the formatting and the insertion of the bits in the particular given payload field or the given data or control field. So coming for the very first field of this particular frame format, we have the access code. So what is this access code? Is it is going to have the length of this is going to be 72 bits, and it contains the synchronization bit in order to tell us and in order to identify the primary to distinguish the frame of one piconet from that of the another piconet. What it means is, if I have multiple number of piconets, I have to notify or I have to recognize which is the primary device of the first piconet, which is the primary device of the second piconet. So that is given here as an access code, which is of 72 bits length. Then we have a header, which is of 54 bits length, which is a repeated 18 bit pattern. So what is that 18 bit pattern is? We have this first field in that header as address. So it's a 3-bit subfield. It's a 3-bit address subfield, which is going to define us that this address is going to start from 1 and it is going to go up to 7. So it will start from 1, it will go up to 7 secondary devices. If the address is 0, it is then it means that the primary is there in the broadcasting communication, means primary is only doing the broadcasting task. If the address is other than 0, then we can say both are primary and secondary are there in the exchange of information. Then we have the next field, which is type. It's a 4-bit type subfield, which is defines which where it defines the type of data coming from the upper layer. And then we have the next field, which is F. This is flow control field, which is 1 bit. When it is set to 1, it indicates that the device is unable to receive more number of frames, which means the buffer is full. Then the next is acknowledgement field, which is again 1 bit. So this acknowledgement, Bluetooth makes use of stop and wait ARQ. Since it is going to make use of stop and wait ARQ, 1 bit is sufficient for the acknowledgement purpose. Then we have the S. S is going to hold the sequence number. So the sequence number here is 1 bit sequence number is being used. Again, since it is going to make use of the Bluetooth is going to make use of stop and wait ARQ, 1 bit sequence number is sufficient here. Then we have the HEC. So the HEC is 8-bit header, which is header error correction subfield is a checksum to detect errors in each 18-bit header section. So this head, as already told, this 18-bit keeps on repeating three times to make it 54. So this hex is helpful for us in looking for the header error corrections, if any. Then coming for the data or the payload part, this consists of 0 to n bits. So those n bits, it depends upon whether I'm going to have a 1 slot frame, 3 slot frame or 5 slot frame. Depending on that, the maximum it can take is, it can go from 0 to 27 bits. So it contains the data or control information cornering from the upper layers. So that's about the frame format, which will be followed by the baseband depending upon the type of the frames that is being transmitted, whether it is a 1 slot frame, 2 slot frame or 3 slot frame getting transmitted. On to the next layer, which is logical link control and adaptation protocol, which is L2 here, which means logical link layer, is roughly, or it is almost equivalent to the LLC sublayer that we have already seen in LAN. It is used for data exchange on an asynchronous communication link and as well as synchronous connection oriented, like asynchronous connectionless link or synchronous connection oriented link. But this L2 CAP is mainly provides the data exchange with the help of ACL than SCQ, which is synchronous connection oriented link. It will not follow this synchronous connection oriented link. It will go for a synchronous connectionless link. So when data integrity is more important than avoiding latency, means asynchronous, like a delay which will be present with respect to few microseconds, few milliseconds, that is there present in any of the devices. So your L2 CAP is going to follow with such kind of latency link technology, which is ACL link. And then the figure shows the format of the data packet at this particular level. This L2 CAP, it is 16-bit length field, which defines the size of the data in bytes. So this is going to be 16-bit length, which is specifying the length of the data in bytes coming from the upper layer, and the data can go from 0 up to 65535 bytes. And the channel ID, which is CID, it defines the unique identifier for the virtual channel created, so which will be of 2 bytes. And then we have the length. Length is going to tell us what would be the length of the whole frame that it is going to transmit to the next higher layer. And there are some specific duties of this particular L2 CAP, such as multiplexing, and then it will also do segmentation and reassembly. And it will also provide cost, which is quality of service, and it is involved in group management. So coming for multiplexing, at the sender side, it accepts the data from one of the upper layer protocols, frames them and delivers them to the baseband. At the receiver side, what it does is, it accepts the frame from the baseband layer, extracts the data, and then delivers them to the appropriate protocol. So it is going to do a kind of to and fro frame transmission in the form of multiplexing from higher layers and the lower layers. Then moving on to segmentation and reassembly. So segmentation is very much important here, because we know the data and control byte which is given here is 65,535 bytes. So the segmenting of the payload, the maximum size of the payload field in the baseband layer is 2774 bits, or if I want to take that in terms of bytes, it is 343 bytes. So we have to take care of such kind of segmentation in order to transmit the larger packets and add extra information to define the exact location of the segments in the original packet, so that when it comes at the receiver end, receiver should be capable of reassembling them at the destination. Coming for the quality of service, cost. Bluetooth allows the stations to define a quality of service levels. So quality of service is nothing but best effort service. So it has to work or it has to give its best under any of the circumstances. That is the Bluetooth device. And then coming for the group management, another functionality of L2CAP is to allow devices to create a type of logical addressing between themselves. This is similar to a kind of multicasting. Example, two or three secondary devices can be a part of multicast group to receive data from the primary. So multicast means from the secondary again it can act as a primary to the another piconet, like we have seen in the scatternet. So the other upper layers which are concerned with respect to your Bluetooth are for specific purposes and are meant for those particular tasks, like we have a layer which is concerned with respect to audio, that is which is there with respect to playing of the music with the help of a Bluetooth device getting connected to a Bluetooth speaker. Hope you all enjoyed. Thank you.